Thank you, Louis. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Cisco Support Committee. Today, we present a live expert series webcast, and our topic today will be Cisco Adaptive Security Appliance ASA Firewalls, Lifeline of Today's Data Centers. My name is Satish Chandran, and I'm the today's moderator. So our expert joining me today is Akhil Ben. Akhil is a solutions architect with Cisco Advanced Services, focusing on Cisco collaboration and security architectures. He leads collaboration and security projects worldwide for the enterprise segment, as well as the collaborative professional services portfolio for the commercial segment. Previously at Cisco, he spent 10 years in various roles at Linksys and Cisco Technical Assistance Center, that's TAC. He holds CCI, Voice and Security Dual Certification, PMP, ITIL, VMware, VCP, and MCP certifications. He has published several research papers in international journals, including IEEE Explorer. He has been a great speaker at prominent industry forums such as Interop, Enterprise Connect, Cloud Summit, CloudSecon, IT Expo, and Cisco Networkers. He is also an author of the book Securing Cisco IP Telephony Networks by Cisco Press. Welcome, Akhil. I think Akhil is on mute. Hey, welcome, Akhil.
Thank you, Satish. It's a pleasure being here today. I also have with me here today Parminder Pal Singh, who is a CCSI certified Cisco technology trainer, and he's working with a partner. And we also have today on board with us Sumanta Bhattacharya, who is a network consultant who works for Cisco Advanced Services.
Okay, great to have you all on board. So now I'd like to briefly outline the format for today's Expert Series webcast. Our expert, Akhil, will start with a presentation on Cisco ASA Firewalls, Lifeline of Today's Data Centers, for the first hour of the program, and then we'll dive into the live question submissions from the audience for the remainder of the event. During our live presentation, you may submit your technical questions to be answered by our expert and expert panelist using the Q&A box on the right-hand side of the console. The team of experts is well-versed in Cisco ASA Firewalls, so please begin posting your questions now to give them the best chance of answering them. If you experience any technical issues, please post your questions also regarding the same. And we'll be asking polling questions during the webcast. We highly encourage you to participate by answering them. You may download a copy of today's PDF presentation using the link that will be posted in the chat. Also, it's on the presentation. The document ID for that is 35104. So once you access the Cisco Support Committee, click on this link and you'll get the PDF copy of today's presentation. So now let's get started with today's event. And let's start with the first polling question. The question for you all is, what is the most important feature from a firewall perspective that you would like to have for your organization? We have four options. Option A, scalability. I should be able to scale the throughput and processing power on an ongoing basis as and when required. Option B, threat protection. I want world-class threat protection from various attacks to safeguard my organization's IT assets and information. Option C is protection of and return on investment. I should be able to leverage new features without replacing the existing hardware. And we have option D. I think I need all of the above, cannot part with anything. The poll is open on the right-hand side. So please begin responding to the option that you think is appropriate. And it will give Akhil the best chance to tailor his presentation. Okay, so poll is on the right-hand side. We'll continue. You can submit your responses so that Akhil can view them. And please make sure to submit your questions as we will answer them later in the webcast. Now, I'd like to hand over the mic to our expert, Akhil, for the presentation. Akhil, over to you.
Thank you, Satish. Good day, everyone. I'll be your host and presenter for this session. And this session, as you can see, it's on Cisco Adaptive Security Appliance. And our motto and theme here is today, lifeline of today's data centers. So how exactly is ASA fitting into that portfolio of protecting vital IT assets and information, whether that's raw data or processed data, data in transit, or data at rest? How ASA can help you achieve that notion and that state where you can protect your vital IT assets within your organization and for your partner organizations? So with that said, let's get started. The agenda for today is we'll start with an introduction to Cisco Adaptive Security Appliance, both 5500 series, which has been there for a long time and has been the Cisco's flagship product in the adaptive security phase, and now the newer 5500X series firewalls. Then we'll delve into how Cisco ASA acts as a next-gen firewall, so what's new and how it can help you achieve that state of sustenance and business continuity where it acts as a borderless firewall and protects you from a host of threats, while at the same time providing your enterprise protection on of the investment, that is, you don't end up going for investing money again and again. So it's a one-time investment and n number of years with the same hardware, with the same platform, leveraging newer features every now and then. And as I can see, the answer for the poll, which was asked a couple of minutes ago, is D. Most of the participants are sticking with D, which is more than 62. So that clearly states the mindset of everyone on this call here today, that you're looking for all the goodies at a nominal cost and want to ensure that your IT assets are protected. Post that, we'll have an insight into the Cisco ASA's firewall clustering feature, which is a new feature only available from iOS version 9.x onwards. So we'll also have a live demo as the part of the presentation today, which will be pointed towards configuration of Cisco ASA clustering and highlighting how exactly different clustering modes come into play. And although we'll be picking up on one mode, but then it'll give you a fair bit of idea of what clustering entails and how exactly it is to be configured, what are the best practices. Post that, we'll go over an overview of the Cisco ASA web security, that is ScanSafe technology, which is again a world-class platform, a cloud-based platform from Cisco, which allows you to do URL filtering, so you kind of get rid of any and all proxies and just use or leverage that feature within ASA. Last but not the least, we'll look at how Cisco ASA fits into the overall TrustSec portfolio, because TrustSec is a vast portfolio. I mean, there is just too many things in there to digest. So we'll focus on how Cisco ASA as a platform enters that portfolio and how you can leverage Cisco ASA to your advantage. At the end of the presentation, you'll have an opportunity to ask questions, but that does not stop you right now to ask questions in the panel. We have Parminder and Samantha here to answer your questions while I'm presenting. So with that note, let's get started. So we'll begin with an introduction of the Cisco ASA 5500 and 5500X platforms and see how that fits into today's data center portfolio. As you can see from this slide, Cisco ASA serves a wide range of solutions, right from small office, home office, to enterprise networks, to data center. So we have Cisco ASA 5505 going to 5510 at the branch office, and then 5520, which is a mid-range firewall, and a bit higher range firewall, 5540, which is an ideal firewall for a small enterprise. Then, of course, we have the 5585 and above. So there are different packages. The 5585 SSP10, which can serve up to 4 gigabits of traffic at any point of time. And then we have 85 SSP20 and 40 and 60. So there are firewalls right from a SOHO usage point of view up to a data center point usage of view for a large enterprise or even a service provider network. So if I were a service provider, I would ideally opt for 5585 SSP60 and have a cluster of them going together to provide redundancy, resilience to the network, and a robust performance. With that said, why Cisco ASA? Why not a competitor? So we have a proven technology track record of over 15 years where Cisco's flagship ASA as a firewall, as a product, has been out there serving Cisco customer base and even replacing older firewalls and competing actively with any other relevant products in the market. So what we have today here is we have more than 1 million ASA units in the market, and this is as of late 2012. The data is as of late 2012. What it also gives you as an edge is it is now extensible, scalable to more than two firewalls. Earlier, you just used to have maybe a failover config for a firewall, an active-active failover or an active standby failover, but then that restricted you as an organization, as a data center, to a limited amount of bandwidth, but now you can go to more than 100 gigabits of traffic per cluster, depending on the platform you go for. So also, what we have here is a world-class security, needless to say. Today's Cisco ASA is built for high performance and is highly scalable. Software-centric, so that's right there. It hits nail on the head because you get investment protection and return on investment because the same platform, by simply revising the firmware on the platform, you can leverage the newer features. By simply getting an additional license on the same hardware, which is a minuscule cost compared to the hardware cost or a replacement cost when you're revamping your network. So you need not do that and just get a new license or a new feature set for the firewall on the same hardware and you're good. I mean, you get all the new world-class security features right then and there without doing anything additional. So what it also entails is Cisco Adaptive Security Appliance gives you maximum uptime, high availability, and greater resiliency compared to the competitive products, and we'll see that in a moment. So high availability today, what we have is, again, it's been a legacy feature of active standby and active-active failover. There is full application state synchronization for TCP protocols. There is zero downtime upgrade, so you can fail over to one firewall and upgrade the other one. There is sub-second failovers, so LAN-based failovers are sub-second. And also along with the same, implicitly comes the reliability and the resilience aspect. That is, you get 2x the reliability of a service-based solution. So let's say we are running a Microsoft L2TP or a Microsoft IPsec server-based solution. Not just it is totally software-reliant, it is also not as resilient as an appliance, because an appliance is purpose-built for a data center or an environment to have those many concurrent connections through it and support those many million connections through it for multi-protocols. At an average, the mean time between failure for a Cisco ASA has been estimated to be between, at an average again, it's 100 to 150K hours. So obviously we do have redundant power supplies just in case a power supply goes down. You obviously have the backup giving you full redundancy and the firewall doesn't feel anything at all. Then there is multi-level resiliency which prevents component, link, and system failure. Now that is more so in picture along with clustering because clustering gives you an advantage. It leverages the power of Cisco ASA and gives you that power or empowers you, in other words, to go for more than two firewalls and club together the overall traffic throughput capacity, the overall resiliency. So let's say you have a cluster, and in a cluster we can go up to eight firewalls. And with a Cisco 5585 SSP60, you can easily go to 120 GPBS of traffic. Now that's a load of traffic. So having a couple of cluster gives you tons of traffic capability and millions of connections at a single point in time through the firewall. So with that, we now come to the next big new thing, which is Cisco ASA 5500X series firewalls. These are very mean firewalls built for mission critical data centers. As you can see, what they do save you on is space. What they give you and empower you with access, performance, compliance, and safeguard your enterprise or organization data against a host of threats. So what they do give you today, we don't know what goodies are up there in the future, but as of today, we have elastic scalability, we have superior span, and we have leading edge security. So the best of the best you can get in a firewall, the next generation of ASA is here today for you to leverage in your data centers. So how exactly it performs at that level? It delivers multi-scale performance. Now that's a Cisco patent in technology to meet the needs of mission critical data centers. How it does it? It increases the number of connections per second to the next level. We'll look into that in a moment. So rapid connections per second, abundance of concurrent sessions, accelerated throughput because everything has been done in the hardware, all in the cards or on the hardware on the firewall. Nothing is software based unless you force it to. Multiple security services such as Cisco clustering, Cisco ScanSafe, Cisco TrustSec, and so on. And those three are the stars of this presentation. And you can span across multiple platforms and deployment scenarios. So it's not necessary that you're working with a 5585 always. You could also have a 5540 or a 5515 or a 5512. And then you can have a mix of those firewalls in various profiles, such as one is a perimeter firewall, the other one is an internal firewall, the third is an IPS firewall, and so on and so forth. So there are limitless number of combinations you can come up with. So here's the next polling question. Based upon what we just discussed, what is the primary role of Cisco ASA in your data center? Is it option A, Cisco ASA is the heart and soul of my data center, and I leverage its next-gen threat protection capabilities in addition to the standard firewall features, that is the legacy features? Or is it B, it's used as a unified threat management or a UTM appliance, protecting my network against a host of threats? Or is it C, it's used as a basic perimeter firewall for filtering traffic? Or at the last, is it D, I don't have Cisco ASA, which would be a very saddening thing though, as of yet in my data center. However, I plan to have its world-class protection for my network very soon. So the poll is open. Please go through it. Please answer this poll so we can understand what exactly is the role of ASA today in your organization for your data center. So while we are answering the question, I'll get rolling with the next slide. The poll will be open for another minute or so, so feel free to answer. It's important to get your inputs here. We value your inputs. So how does Cisco ASA and ASA 5500 series or 5500X series firewalls, they fit into the next-gen data center? When we are talking about the next-gen data center, we are talking about borderless networks. There is no border as we see it today. We are talking about BYOA, BYOD, and we are talking about Wi-Fi. We are talking about routing and switching. We are talking about service provider. We are talking about security. All of that in borderless networks. You never know who is walking in with what device. So ideally, the services in your network should be device agnostic. The services should be platform agnostic. Anyone and everyone who walks in should be able to leverage, at the least, as per your organization policies, the services they are meant to, as a guest or as an employee or as a vendor or as a contractor. So how exactly Cisco ASA is serving that purpose? as you can see in this slide, what we have is there are business imperatives. We have sensitive information from different sources. At the same time, you just cannot allow everyone to access everything because there are security imperatives which are opposing the business imperatives, which say maintain regulatory compliance and manage the risks well. So what is needed today is to simplify IT security by providing a platform where people can leverage corporate resources without compromising any IT compliance or corporate security rules. So what we can see here is, this is the fact. This is what we have today going on in most of the organizations, if not all. So we have external facing applications, we have internal applications, we have a mobile worker, we have IT consumerization, which can happen from any device. Could it be an iPad, could it be an Android, it could be a MacBook, it could be a PC, it could be a desktop, you never know. Someone is coming with Ubuntu on his or her laptop, so you never exactly know who is coming in with what and what they are meant to do within the network. So essentially, it's a borderless world today. Everywhere, anytime, anywhere, accessibility is the mantra for today. And what are the data center challenges which we intend to resolve? Space. Data centers are an expensive affair. If you have a huge data center, you already know that. So space is a primary concern. You want to crunch the space as small as possible. Then there is accessibility, there is performance, there is compliance, because some data centers, especially in financial institutes or banking institutions, or DoD, for example, they have to comply with certain standards, PCI, HIPAA, so on. And then, of course, there is a host of threats out there, which if you try to compromise somewhere by performance or access or compliance, you face all the threats, and then eventually your network goes down if it's not built up to standard. So how do you find that fine balance between investment and doing what you need to do and doing what you're meant to do? So what ASA has to offer is superior scalability. You can have, now this is about a single firewall. You can have up to 350,000 connections per second, 8 million concurrent connections, 35 gigabits multi-protocol throughput, clustering up to 8 firewalls. Now, that's a linear increase in the throughput. So the clustering can take you up to 120 gigabits per second per cluster of 8 firewalls on 5585. Then you have, obviously, lower power consumption, which gives you an edge over the other products, which may comply with the FCC standards, but at the end of the day, you end up spending a lot on cooling costs, on power costs, and so on. So obviously, the next point is lower cooling costs, because if you're consuming less power, you need lesser amount of cooling to be done with. And all of this in just 2 RUs. I mean, this was never possible till today, but the ASA 5500X series is making it all possible. So all in all, what we have today is 8x the performance density of the competitive firewalls. And when we say competitive, we are judging against Juniper and Checkpoint majorly, and the other small players such as Palo Alto. What we also have is superior span across security verticals. That goes without saying. We have been talking all throughout till now about borderless and devices, BYOD, BYOA, bring your own asset. So at the end of the day, how do you imply security across platforms, across devices, which is consistent, which is easy to manage, and which is visible? So the IT workforce has visibility into the security, what they want to do, what they are achieving out of it. So obviously what you have is, and what you want to have in place is threat protection acceptable use, access control, and data loss prevention. All of that across a broad OS platform support with minimal device requirements. I mean, it should not be the case that you have to keep reconfiguring the firewall. Okay, today I faced this threat. Let me reconfigure the firewall. Okay, today someone accessed such and such site. It should not be allowed. Let me refine the rules. So on and so forth. That is a thing in history. That's a thing in past. Now what we want today is intelligence threat defense. And that is exactly what Cisco ASA is capable of delivering in today's demanding environment. So platform agnostic security, again, one of the most important things is if I walk in as an employee and I have an iPad, what all access should I get on my iPad? Tomorrow, Akhil can walk in with an Android tablet, or he can walk in with his iPhone, or he can walk in day after with a MacBook. Is my access around all the devices the same? Do I get the same corporate access? How does the MDM, the mobile device management strategy, come into the picture? So that is exactly what you can leverage right out of the box with ASA, with TrustSec, with ScanSafe. That is the mantra for success. So you have the choice what you want to do. You give the choice to the user, the power to the user. They can bring in any and all devices and still they'll be supported. At the same time, you have rich, granular security policy experience. That is, you can go as deep down as give this tagging to this user if he's an employee. Give this tagging to this user if he or she is a vendor. Now, if a guest walks in, the guest gets just the internet access. So it's not just about secure network admission control, but it's a consistent experience across all the devices. So that's exactly what it is. Always on intelligent connection for seamless experience and performance. With that, we come to the first topic of Cisco's ASA firewall clustering. Our emphasis would be on firewall clustering, TrustSec, and ScanSafe. So this would be the first topic out of those three. And by firewall clustering, although I already revealed it earlier in the presentation, we can combine up to 8 ASA 5580 series platform or 5585 series platform. So as of today, only these two platforms are supported of Cisco ASA's firewall family. And you can cluster up to 8 firewalls to combine the throughput and to make sure that things go as per your corporate policy. So why clustering? Why do you even want to do clustering? Clustering gives you up to 100 plus GPBs of traffic through ASA appliances. So you can cluster up to 8 firewalls and get up to 100 plus GPBs, to be precise, 120 gigabit per second with an 5585 platform. The ease of ongoing management, because the firewall in a cluster becomes one and whole. If there are 8 firewalls in the cluster, you can manage them as one firewall, one big chunk of firewall. You can achieve deployment simplicity. Of course, high availability, you're talking about 8 firewalls or one or more firewalls in a cluster. So obviously that talks about high availability and investment protection right there, because at the end of day, even if a couple of firewalls are down, you don't have to worry about it. Your network will still function, although with lower throughput, lower capacity. Now compare this to ASA failover, where you have just 2 firewalls to deal with. If both the units go down, you're done. But in a cluster, if you have 8 units, 2 units, or 3 units go down, you still have plenty of backup to support your organization's business continuity functions. So what are the major highlights of clustering? Why should you even opt for it? The first one is obviously the scaling factor. The total throughput equals n times the single node. So it's a linear scaling. If one firewall can deliver 35 GPBs, 8 firewalls can deliver 35 into 8 into 0.7. That factor is always there while calculating for design. GPBS. End-to-end high availability. All the units are active, so all the units are participating. Like in an ASA active standby failover, only the active process is the traffic. The standby is down. It only becomes active when the active firewall is offline. However, in case of a cluster, whether that's a spanned cluster or an individual interface cluster, we'll come to that in a couple of slides. All the firewalls are active at the same time. They all know about what's going on in other firewalls. So even if one fails, the other one is aware about it. And there is seamless traffic redistribution. So you don't have to worry about it. It's the network which does the magic. So in case of spanned firewalls, LACP, or channel, that gives you automatic load balancing across the firewalls. In case of individual interfaces, we need to have either a policy-based routing or, say, Cisco ACE, or any other traffic distributor which can distribute the traffic between the firewalls, because in that case, we are using routed mode. Manageability, as I mentioned earlier, when you are managing a firewall cluster, you are managing essentially one firewall. So whatever commands you post to it, whether that's on ASDM or on CLI, it's pretty much replicated to every other firewall in the cluster, so you don't have to go to each and every unit and do that. The same level of redundancy, every traffic flow has a backup within the cluster. So in case the master, the cluster has a concept of master and slave, so only one unit is a master, the other is a slave, as we'll see in some time. So even if the master goes down, the first slave with the highest priority acquires the role of a master, and then the traffic is not impacted because, as I said, the traffic is replicated across the cluster. Every member knows about the traffic flow. So even if there was a three-way handshake being set up, so there was a SYN and there was a SYN ACK, and then ACK was coming in at the time the unit went down, another unit can still handle that. So this is how exactly a cluster would look like. You can have up to 8 ASA appliances in a cluster. There should be a load balancing approach. Either that's done at an Ether channel level LACP, or you can use a router-based equal cost multipathing, or you can use a policy-based routing. Now, everything depends on what type of approach you're taking for clustering. Like in case of spanned ports, you can go with Ether channels and LACP. In case of individual routed ports, that is, you have an outside and an inside and a management and maybe a DMZ, then you can go with a router-based traffic distribution, a PBR or ECMP. Then, of course, you have in-cluster high availability via cluster control link. So that is the crux. The cluster control link allows the firewalls to share the state information amongst themselves. Not just the state, but also the traffic information. That is, at the end of the day, each firewall knows what is flowing in other firewalls. And in case the other unit goes unresponsive, the cluster control link tells the other firewalls that the earlier unit is not available. You should come online as a master or still remain as a slave, but process the traffic. And the most important advantage it gives you is it gives you hitless upgrades. So you can transition a slave to a master. So if in case you have to upgrade an 8 ASA cluster, 8 units in a cluster to the next iOS release. So what you do is you start with the slaves, and at the last you have master. So you can make an already upgraded slave as a master and then upgrade that master and make it back as a master. So eventually your network never felt anything. It was no touch and feel for it because it never knew what happened while the firewalls were being upgraded. So hitless upgrade is one of the most important features here. So clustering highlights before we get into the live demo. All the units in the cluster are active and passing traffic. Clustering can be configured in individual mode or span mode. This is very important. You have to make a conscious decision as per the topology in your environment, in your organization, as to what suits you the best. All the units in cluster are either owner or backup on a session-by-session basis. In case of a node failure, the backup units, they take over the session as we just discussed. Use of LACP allows neighboring switches to stop sending traffic to the failed unit, and that's what the cluster control link also does. It tells the other firewall that this unit is down, it's out of cluster. Single configuration console, that could be the CLI or ASDM. And it in a cluster, it automatically does configuration sync across the cluster. There is remote command execution to any node, as we'll see in a moment. And then there is cluster-wide resource usage statistics. So this is the topology for the live demonstration. And let me go ahead and share for this live demonstration. Share my desktop. So what we are going to do, we have two firewalls as per the topology. And what I'm doing is I'm connecting to one of the firewalls, which is supposed to be the master, which is ASA1. And I'm going to use ASDM for the whole configuration. Okay. So before we can actually get started with the configuration of a firewall, I hope all of you can see my desktop. So before we get started with the configuration of a firewall in a cluster mode, we have to define what exactly is the mode you're going in with. In this case, as you can see, there is an inside interface. On the right-hand top, you have an inside interface and a management interface and an outside interface. So since we have routed interfaces, we want to maintain IP addresses. We'll go with individual interface configuration. So to configure the firewall or cluster in this case, so right now, as you can see, if I do not issue the command on CLI, that is cluster interface mode, it can be spanned, it can be individual. If I do not have that command executed on the master, you would not see this tab of ASA cluster, which is right now right here. It says cluster interface mode, individual interface, cluster is not enabled. So what we are going to do now is we're going to enable the cluster. So I'll get started with the high availability setup. And as you can see right away, there is hardware model ASA 5580 40 SSP. Then there is a software revision, which is one of the latest and greatest on CCL, a stable release of 903. And what we have here is the cluster mode again is individual interface. And if you can compare this to a regular HA config, the active-active failover, active standby failover, everything is disabled. And in fact, when you enable clustering, there are a lot of features which are not available. We'll cover that after the demo. So the only available option is ASA cluster. So let's say next. So what it asks me to do is either set up a new ASA cluster or join an existing cluster. So I'm going to set up a new ASA cluster. Right, so here it says, this ASA is currently in the individual cluster interface mode, which is the routed mode. In case you want to go with an Ether channel load balancing model, you can go with the span mode. Or the other one, we already have it enabled. So we can just go next. This was just for information. This is an FYI only screen. Okay, so what we have here is we have Gigabit Ethernet 8.0 as the inside, Gigabit 8.1 as the outside, and then we have management 0.0. So before we enable clustering on an individual interface firewall where we want to keep the firewall with right IP addresses, what entails is that since this would be spanned across the cluster, we have to create a pool of IP addresses. Each firewall may have its unique IP address you can reach to it, but in a cluster, it will use an IP address from the pool. And you can relate this to a VPN pool, like in a VPN, remote access VPN, you create an IP pool, and off that IP pool, you assign an IP address to a remote access VPN client. Similarly here, each cluster-enabled firewall will pick an IP address from the pool of the master. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to create a pool. For that, I'll click Edit. And for the inside interface, let's create a pool. In fact, I can create a pool for all the interfaces right here. So what I'll say is this is inside pool. The starting IP address should be of the same subnet range. And the ending IP address, because we can have up to 8 members in the cluster, I'll limit it to 8. And then, of course, it's /24. So there we go. So we are done with the inside pool, but it's a good opportunity to add the other pools as well. So I'll add a pool for the outside interface. Got a typo here, just corrected it. Okay. So now we have an out pool, and last but not the least, we'll add a management pool. Okay, so we are all done here. We added 3 pools. Now what we want to do is, since we are on the inside interface, we want to assign the in pool to the inside interface. Say okay. Say okay. And we are done with that. Now let's go to the outside interface. We already created a pool, we just have to assign it. There we go. And we're good with the outside interface as well. Last one left is the management interface. Let's do that one. So we have the MGMT pool here. Let's click assign. Okay. And we're all good. So what we just did, we assigned a pool of IP addresses on the master, because this is the first ASA, we are making it at master. So the moment another ASA joins the cluster, it will borrow an IP of this IP address pool. It's just like, as I said, it's an analogy to the VPN configuration, a remote access VPN. So we go next. Here it is asking us to fill in the cluster name. So we can call this as ASA cluster. This is the first member, so ASA1. So now this, the member priority decides who is the master. So in this case, you have option from 1 to 100. So I can start with 1. If I give 1, this will become the master. Any following ASA can have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If you start with 10, and then you give 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and so on. So 10 becomes the master. But if you start with 10 and give another ASA 9, then 9 will become the master. So it's important to keep a check on that one. So there is an option for shared key, which is just like a key chain. I'll just put in shared key as Cisco. And now one of the non-routed interfaces, one of the IP, non-IP address assigned interfaces, I have to pick and choose. So that's Gigit Ethernet 8.2, I just did. And give it a subnet of a unique range. So I'll start with 101. So this has to be different from any other subnets. Of course, you cannot have the same subnet on one or more interfaces, but this, ideally, try and keep it different from any other subnet ranges, because if your network is doing summarization, this could land you into trouble. Right, so we are done here. And then it shows the master config. There we go. So these are the commands it will be implying on the ASA. The moment I say finish, ASDM is going to try and deliver these commands. However, Unified communications is not supported with clustering. So you'll see there are some incompatible commands. And although I love to see UC work with firewalls, in case of cluster, unfortunately, as of today, it is not supported. So it's going to remove all of those good UC commands. So I don't have an option. I'll say OK. I hope this feature comes in future. There is a roadmap for it. So let's just sit tight for a minute or so. And while it's configuring clustering, so right now it says ASDM is enabling clustering. And shortly, it'll come up with the pop-up that now this ASA is the master and this is the IP address assigned on the interface we are connecting. So right now we are connected to inside, which is 10.10.10.101. So along with 101, you should be able to see another IP address which was derived from the pool. So we started with 10.10.10.110 to 118. So ideally this ASA should pick up 110. Okay, it should be any second now. So one more thing to keep in mind that when you enable clustering, the firewall will lose connectivity temporarily with the ASDM. Unless you are on a console, you will lose connectivity, but then it'll come back up. So almost there. It should be popping up any second now, saying that this ASA is now a cluster master. Okay, in the background, you can perhaps already see the member ASA1. Here we go. Okay. So member ASA1 has been successfully added to cluster ASA cluster. So we have it. And as I said earlier, we have 10.10.10.101, which is the physical IP on the interface. And it pulled up one more IP from the pool, specifying this is the first member in the cluster. So now what it says is, do you want to add another member into this cluster? I'll say yes. Why not? While we are at it. So what's the member name? I'll give it ASA2. Priority, I already gave one to the master, so this is going to be the slave. So what's the IP address for the interface? I'll pick up the next IP, which is 176.16.1.102. And since I have ASDM enabled, I'll just send it across. So we are going to deliver the commands via ASTM. So these are the commands, as you can see, cluster name, member, priority, shared key. So the cluster control link interface is here. This is where it shares the health information on the cluster information for the ASA. So click finish. And as you can see, I get another security warning because it is trying to connect to the second firewall on port 443 for ASDM. I'll say continue. So this will again take a minute or so, and after that it should show us that it has added the ASA2, which was the name of the member, as a slave to the cluster. And the notion would be slave for this firewall, and again it's going to ask us if we want to add another firewall, but since we have just two firewalls here, we'll be done with it. And after that I'll just walk you through home and monitoring options for clustering. Here we go. So as you can see, now we have ASA2, which is a slave, and which now has the second IP address from the pool. Now this is for the inside, although on the firewall itself, it'll have the IP address from the pool for management and outside interfaces as well. So I'll just say no for another next member. I'm good. My clustering is done. And as you can see here, we have ASA cluster master and slave. let's go back to home. And now you can see there is cluster dashboard in addition to the device dashboard and firewall dashboard. Earlier it was saying ASA cluster. Now there is cluster dashboard. What it's saying is it's showing the status of the firewalls for some of the interfaces if they're down, because they might still be coming up. Now there is firewall dashboard. Let's go to that. So here you can see how much traffic is actually passing through the firewall. What are the drop packet rate? What are the possible SYN attack rates? So on and so forth, the usual firewall clustering. So if you want to say now you're in middle of an upgrade and you want to make a master as a slave to upgrade it, so how do you do that? Go to monitoring. Under monitoring, choose ASA cluster. And here we go. So it's showing you the actual configuration and the status of the cluster. So what you have here is Cisco ASA cluster is on. This, so it's telling about the current firewall I'm connected to is ASA 1 is in state master, its information, and the cluster IP, TCL IP. Then other members in the cluster, there's ASA 2, and then it's TCL IP, and then its state is slave. So what I can do is I can change the master to ASA right from here. Now, if I have more than few firewalls here, or more than one firewall, I can make anyone as a master in case I want to upgrade this current firewall. So I can connect to the individual IP address and upgrade the firmware or have a patch done to it. So this is pretty simple from a management point of view. You can keep an eye on the cluster. You can look at the CPU usage across the cluster. You can look at the memory usage across the cluster, so on and so forth. And of course, there are traffic graphs. You can look at the connections and the throughput. So what's the traffic going through the cluster? And what's the throughput rate of the cluster? So since now the firewall is one and whole, you'll see just one IP address, which is the primary one, and this is the one I'm connected to. But if you see the running config of the firewall right now, of either of those two firewalls, it'll be exactly the same, except for the physical IP addresses on the interface. If the host name of firewall one was ASA1, the other one will also show as ASA1. So that's the configuration for individual interfaces or routed firewall. You can also do for Ether channel. In that case, you have to span the ports together and then assign the CCL link to the span ports and then configure it accordingly. It's all available under the wizard. You just have to put the firewall in the right interface mode as per your organization requirements or policies. So coming back to the presentation, so these are the clustering limitations, high notes. Not all inspection engines are available in the cluster mode, as we saw that as soon as we enabled clustering, the prompt was that there were some service policies and some inspections, such as H323, SIP, SKINNY, RTSP, RTP, RTCP, which were not supported. So in that case, you really cannot enable those. Remote access VPN is not available. All the point-to-point, site-to-site VPN is available and centralized to one node. So that could be the master node. And again, that also implies the first point. We could relate it to the last one. Unified communication is not supported in clustered mode. Now let's again hope that it is, because in today's data center, unified communication is an integral piece, and I hope it's on the roadmap that we support it tomorrow. With that said, the next feature, the next highlight would be Cisco ASA Scan Safe technology, which enables you to do URL filtering in a granular manner such that you can imply access on a session-by-session or a person-by-person basis. So what exactly is ScanSafe? It's the best-in-class. So what with ASA, it goes without saying that you get best-in-class network security, but along with that, you also get best-in-class cloud-based web security because ScanSafe is nothing local. It's not a local web proxy. It's a Cisco-hosted solution where the ASA connects and it looks into its rules and compares it with the online updated database to say whether this URL is a good URL or not, not a good URL to allow the user to access it. So what ScanSafe really is, the web page or the web content goes through multiple AV scanners. Right then and there, malware, which is a known malware, is blocked. Now the clean content is sent towards the ScanSafe cloud, and based upon the rules on the ASA and the ScanSafe database, those scanlets, so you can see there are multiple scanlets. There is a script scanlet and a flash scanlet and an EXE scanlet. So that does a deep packet or payload inspection, and at that point of time, reverts back to ASA whether this is a known threat or a known bad destination. Don't go to it, block it right away. Or if it is allowed and it is a mediocre risk, it'll allow it based upon your organization policies. Say a CIO wants to access the web and play a game on a PC in his free time. Should you allow it or not? For a CIO, I guess you would. But for an HR personnel or an employee, you want to maximize their productivity time. So just an example. So what it entails is there are multiple web applications, close to 100,000 apps, which are supported by ScanSafe. And of these 1,000-plus apps, you have around 75,000-plus micro apps. So within Facebook, you can have multiple games. So you can upload a picture, but you cannot play a game. The moment you click on a game link, depending upon your profile as a vendor or a contractor or as an employee, you're either allowed access or blocked access. But the moment you try to upload your picture, that is allowed because that scanlet is allowing you to do it on the ASA. ASA allows that traffic. So the moment you search Google, there would be multiple links, but depending upon your profile, you can click on certain links, you cannot click on the other links. So there is a use case how you can really go for a flexible policy enforcement along with the Cisco web cloud-based URL filtering intelligence. So for example, a CIO wants to access Facebook, play Farmville on it, and access some files on the internet, maybe FTP, maybe just some HTTP files to be downloaded. So when the CIO goes through, the files are all allowed. All the access is open for the CIO profile because you configured ASA that anyone coming with a certain tag or a user ID is allowed to do all of this. Now, let's transpose this onto an HR personnel. When the HR personnel tries to do so, he or she is allowed Facebook, allowed the file web server, but cannot play Farmville from within Facebook. That is denied right away. The ScanSafe is kicking in and saying this user doesn't have the right to do what he or she is asking to do. So all in all, what we have is identity-aware cloud-based web security. It supports per-context ScanSafe redirection, multiple antivirus engines, and web content scanlets. So post ScanSafe, what we have is one of the most intriguing and important topics of TrustSec. Now, what exactly is TrustSec? Many of you might have that question as well. So what is Cisco TrustSec? What all it entails? It covers everything having to do with identity. It could be .1x, could be profiling technologies, could be guest services, could be security group access, which is the major point of control mechanism related to ASA and ICE, the Cisco Identity Services Engine. We'll look into that in a second. And then you have Access Control Server, AAA, or RADIUS. And, of course, these latest and greatest, which is Cisco ICE, which gives you much more than the older model of NAC. So it's the new gen Mac NAC for you. So what exactly is SGA? SGA entails many a things. That implies SGACS, Security Group Access Control List. So Secure Group Access has access lists which are or can be implied based upon the current user profile or the user attribute. And how that is done is based upon an SGT or a security group tag. So what is a security group tag? It's a function of one or more user or system attributes. In this case, we are taking an example of user or a group or a posture or a device ID, IP, certificate. So essentially, a security group tag, if I'm given a tag of, say, 003, I'm an employee and I can access everything. If I'm given a tag of 007, my PC is quarantined because at the end of the day, it does not have the right antivirus on it or the antivirus is not updated, so I need posture remediation. If I'm given 008, I'm a guest. So an SGT is a tag to allow you or not to allow you in a network, and if you are allowed, what all you can do, it authorizes you to do something and you are also accounted for it. So all in all, it's a function of various dictionaries, the simplest way to put it. So this is an example of ASA TrustSec, how exactly that pitches in next-gen data center protection. So you have various users. They are coming in from various locations. Could be from New York, from California, Munich, New Zealand. And based upon where the user is coming from or what the user credentials are, or what the user device is, you can have the security group filtering right there. That security group filtering based on SGT on the ASA, which allows you to send the traffic to the data center. So for all the users from any location, what we are allowing here is essentially we allow access to data server 1. We allow access to SAP servers. However, we do not allow access to the ESXi or the VMware infrastructure. So what it can allow you to do, the security TrustSec or the SGT, the security group tagging, it allows you to trim down your security rules, the 5-tuple rules, down to 50 rules from 500,000. So if you have, say, 500,000, you can trim them down approximately to 50 rules. What SGT can also do, it can be a function of one or many attributes, as we saw in the last slide. It can be a user attribute, can be an IP address, could be a certificate, could be a device ID, could be many of things. So all in all, what you can do in your environment is you can couple the SGT along with the ASA 5-tuple rules and create granular policy. Say someone is coming in from a trusted zone, and if the SGT is 3, that is of employee, based upon the user ID authenticated against the LDAP, the user is allowed to access everything, including the VMware. If the SGT is 7007, it would be a vendor, and the vendor is only allowed to access his server, not the SAP database or VMware. So we can do a lot, and there are case studies around that in the presentation in a moment. We'll look at that as well. So how exactly it is done? The policy definition is done on the ICE, and what we can see here is right there we have the security group tagging. We have different security tags of 003, 005, 004, 006, and what they are allowed to access. So for some, it's a deny. For all others, it's permit. So it depends, such as the management SGT. So to the web server, it's permitted. To credit the time card server, it's not permitted. To manager portal, it is because it's a management function. And then again, to employee portal, the management should have access. But to the credit card, it doesn't make sense. So that security group tag right there defines what the management folks can or cannot access. Now we'll amplify this in a moment with some use cases. Now how these SGTs are applied. So if you look at this, these SGTs are applied on the outside rules and right there, the highlighted areas. You have different SGTs and what destination they can or cannot access. So the moment a packet comes in or a payload comes in, ASA redirects it to the ICE server and says, ICE, is this allowed to do what it's asking to do? ICE says yes or no, and if it says yes, then immediately ICE kicks in and starts accounting for that function and authorization for that user. So that's exactly how it is done. And this will be more clear by the next example. So this is Cisco TrustSec in action. So what we have here is my iPad. I come in with an iPad into the office, Cisco office, and I try to go online and access the company's internal web portal. Now, would I have access to it? Based upon my user ID right here at the top, right here at the top, we have the SGT access. So SGT 003, user equals AKBell, which is my Cisco ID. So ICE has that, and then at the end of day, what it does is ASA, the moment it gets my request using my username, SGT3, it sends it across to ICE. ICE tells it SGT3 is allowed to access corporate servers. So I get access, irrespective of whether I'm coming from my iPad or my iPhone or my Android tablet or my PC or my Mac. So that security group tag becomes single point of contact, and in this case, the dictionary or the attribute I'm using is my username. And ASA is playing along with ICE in the overall scenario to say what this user is allowed to do and what level of access this user gets in the network. So the use cases. What we have here is user AKBell, which is myself. I authenticate from a corporate asset such as my laptop, and I immediately get assigned to SGT 007, which is quarantine. Why did that happen? Because the ICE saw that my antivirus was turned off. So it did a posture assessment based upon my user ID and assigned me to a quarantine zone, saying that a posture remediation has to be done. The antivirus has to be turned on. Either it will do it itself or the administrator can do it for me. So once the AV is turned on, I get assigned 88008. That is compliant, and the moment I get compliant, I have access to everything within the network. Right here. Allow full access to enterprise servers because I got 008. Another use case. So what we have here is a user guest walking into the premises, say Cisco office, and the user authenticates from guest iPad. Now, since it's a guest, they wouldn't have a username or a password to authenticate against the LDAP server of Cisco or the organization they walk into. So the guest by default gets an SGT or a security group tag of 100, and 100 is only allowed access. On ASA, ICE tells only give access to internet. So at the end of the day, the guest ends up using the internet only from within the premises, nothing else. So what we have here is now an interesting question, another polling question for you. What do you leverage ASA's next-gen security features such as clustering, ScanSafe, or TrustSec for? Do you leverage them at all? A, I leverage all the three features in my data center environment and am realizing the benefits. Is it B, I intend to or leverage all, or some of these features for maximizing the throughput and scalability, reliable web filtering, and BYOD policy implementation, and hope that these will help me bring down the total cost of ownership and increase my return on investment. C, I'm not sure if these features will be useful in my environment at all, and I need further information to make a conscious decision. And D, I don't intend to use any of these features in near future. Would appreciate if you can answer to this, because these three features are next-gen data center features, and if you already have ASA going for you, ideally these features would come in most handy and would give you an immediate return on your investment without upgrading a platform if you have a 5580 or an 85. And I hope in future this feature is also extended to other platforms, such as a 5540 or a 5515X. So you can leverage it from the existing platforms. But as of today, this is meant for data centers, and for it's limited to 5580 and 5585.
Okay, so while everyone responds to the polling question three, we are getting a lot of questions. That's really good. And I'm sure Sumant and Parminda, they are really busy. So Akhil, it was a great presentation. And thank you everyone for participating in the polling. So now it's time to answer some of the questions that our viewers are asking and have submitted today. And just in case if you can't stay with us for the Q&A, please be sure to click on the evaluation that will pop up once you close the browser to let us know how the session met your business needs and expectations. And shortly we'll also post the link in the chat window also, the survey link. And these are some of the references. So for on the same topic, yeah. Akhil, would you like to briefly go through that, or?
Sure. So these are some of the references. As you can see, there is Cisco ASA product portfolio updates and new features and everything related to Cisco ASA on cisco.com go ASA. There is the Cisco ASA startup and basic configuration guide available on firewall.cx, which are collaborating with CSC as of today. So it's a really neat guide to get started with your ASA. Then there is this reference for both UC and security, Cisco IP, securing Cisco IP telephony networks, which you can leverage to your advantage. And last but not the least, it's the Cisco ASA configuration guides, where you can get a hands-down configuration for anything you need right off CCO.
And I think the polling results are out, so you might want to comment on that.
Great. So I see most of the attendees intend to leverage the feature. So that is good, because I do understand 9.x is just out. People are waiting and evaluating it. But it's good to see that there is a passion for leveraging these features. And I hope for everyone it works out in terms of your investment protection and the return of investment, plus you get world-class security features, goes without saying, by leveraging these three features. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So let me take a few questions that have come in. Akhil, the first question is, how can ASA clustering help me achieve more bandwidth, and if it's linear figure?
So clustering, although I mentioned it earlier in the presentation, when you cluster ASA, it's one or more ASAs. It is a linear figure. There is a factor of 0.7. So let's say we are going with 8 5585 firewalls. Each firewall is capable of supporting up to 40 gigabits of traffic through it. So if we do, say, 8 firewalls, that is more than 100 gig of traffic, but the equation would be 40 into 8 into 0.7. So that would be the total bandwidth or the pipe you will get through a cluster. So a cluster helps you increase the overall bandwidth. An analogy would be, say, a firewall failover, in which case you do not get concurrent bandwidth increase. It's just one or the other firewall playing in, or both the firewalls, but then the traffic is load balanced. So essentially, failover never gives you that advantage, which clustering can.
Okay, thank you. Another question is, does ASA support stateful sync for SSL or IPsec VPN sessions? Means, suppose primary fails, then SSL or IPsec VPN session need not re-establish connectivity with secondary.
So in case of clustering, and in case of plain ASA legacy, yes, it does. In case of clustering, as I mentioned earlier in the presentation, you have to focus on a site-to-site VPN because remote access VPN is not supported. So if it's a site-to-site IPsec VPN, because SSL is not site-to-site. So in that case, it state will be maintained throughout the cluster as well, yes.
Okay, thank you. There is another question that says, how is ASA clustering different from ASA failover?
I answered that in the first question, Satish. When we do ASA failover, it's one or the other firewall. So let's say it's an active standby failover. At that time, one firewall is processing traffic actively while the other one is passive. In an active failover, both the firewalls, they process traffic, but at the end of the day, they are just processing traffic in a load balancing fashion. They are not giving you 100% throughput of each firewall combined together. But in clustering, it's imperative and it's implicit that when you add one or more firewalls, the bandwidth, say one firewall can support up to 20 GPBS. When you add two firewalls, it's 40 GPBS which you get. When you add three, it's 60 and so on. So in a cluster, the firewall cluster becomes one and whole, and the pipe you have for the bandwidth also becomes one and whole. So it's just a linear increase in the bandwidth with a multiplication factor of 0.7, which one should consider for design.
Okay, those details really helps. A few other questions, and just to let all the attendees know that if we miss some of the questions, Akhil will be answering them in the FAQ that we'll be posting in the community. So Akhil, another question, does Packet Tracer support FWSM, Firewall Service Model? Does Packet Tracer support FWSM?
Packet Tracer? Yeah, it's a feature. It's a feature set, and it would. My guess is it would, but to be honest with you, I haven't worked with FWSM and Packet Tracer together, but my hunch is it would.
Okay, great. Another question that says, is there a concept of inter-context communication in current ASA? Just to clarify,
can you expand on that question? Mm-hmm.
Sorry?
No, go ahead.
Sorry. Yeah, just to clarify on that, meaning no need to forward the traffic out of the interface, but instead inside ASA and between context. Saves interface and much faster. So that's the question.
Can you read out that question once again, Satish?
Yeah, is there a concept of interconnect context communication in current ASA?
So when you create contexts, the contexts are created to keep sanity between two or more organizations or working units. So if you want to interconnect two contexts, you eventually have to go out of ASA and come back into another context. Interconnectivity of the context within the firewall is not possible.
Okay, another question. Based on active cluster configuration, if new firewall picks an IP address from the pool, if the firewall goes down, how the session failover will happen? The live session will be dropped or it will fail over to the active firewall?
So in a cluster, the simple concept is whenever firewall becomes part of a cluster, the CCL or the cluster control link keeps a track of different firewalls and also replicates the states between the firewall plus also replicates the sessions in the firewall. Say there is a packet coming in, as I explained earlier during the presentation in the beginning. that if there is a SIN which comes into the fire, into the network through firewall, say, number 4, and there is an ACK, SIN ACK going out of firewall number 4, there is an ACK coming in at the same time firewall 4 goes down, CCL would already have notified the other members of the current state of that session, and that ACK would be processed by, say, firewall 5 or 6 or 7, whosoever is the next owner of the session. So there is a concept of owners, and the owners and the directors, they share session database or session state amongst themselves. It will be wrong to say between, because between is just for 2 firewalls. So if you have, say, 8 firewalls, the state of the session, every packet flow is shared with the next owner in line as per the priority.
Thank you. Another question on TrustSec. How TrustSec allows for granular policy definition?
So even though I explained it using an example, I'll give another one. So say I'm an employee and I walk in with a partner who is a good friend of mine, a partner employee. So when I go to a Cisco office, I have Wi-Fi access and I put in my credentials, and TrustSec allows me full access to the network. The partner tries to connect to Cisco Wi-Fi, and the moment they get into the guest Wi-Fi access, their security group tag will be different from my security group tag. Mine was based upon the unique attribute of user ID, and theirs would be based upon the guest ID. Their user ID is guest ID. So for all the guests, it will be guest ID. And then they would be put into a certain VLAN by Cisco ASA and TrustSec running. Eventually, TrustSec is, as I said, it's a vast umbrella. It encompasses ASA, ICE, and you obviously have the switches playing a vital part in TrustSec, and then the wireless access point and wireless controllers. So one or the other way, the computer will be assigned to a Wi-Fi VLAN, which is only meant for guests. And that too, ICE will keep an eye on that user as to what that user is accessing on the web. And at that point of time, the user can be, if the user tries to access, say, a Cisco confidential website, he'll be immediately blocked access to, because that is not allowed from that user ID or security group tag. For me, being an employee and coming in with my employee ID as a dictionary attribute for HTT, I would be allowed access to it.
Right. So in the interest of time, I'll take one more question. But again, to all attendees, all your questions will be responded by Akhil, Sumanta, and Parminder later via the FAQ. And also, there is an Ask the Expert coming up, so you can ask follow-up questions there as well. So one last question I'll take. Let me see. Okay, so what is the VPN split in IPv4 or IPv6 network? That's the question. Is there VPN bypass with ASA?
Well, if the question is about VPN bypass, if you want to bypass ASA and connect to a VPN headend on, say, the inside of the network, if that's what the question is, yes, it's possible. It has been possible for many years, because ASA doesn't block VPN if you configure the policies correctly, say, on the outside interface. So say I'm traveling and I want to connect my PC to my corporate resources, and I use an ASA on the inside, which is on the protected zone, to terminate my VPN, and my perimeter ASA is on the outside of the inside ASA. I know it's a little convoluted, but say there is ASA 1 and ASA 2. ASA 1 is on the inside on the corporate network, protecting the corporate assets. And ASA 2 is sitting at the perimeter at the ISP level. So I bypass ASA 2 and connect to ASA 1 when I initiate an SSL or an IPsec session, provided that the ASA has the right access lists and allows, say, a range of IPs or any to go through it. So VPN bypass is supported, whether on IPv4 or on IPv6.
Okay, thanks, Akhil. So that concludes the Q&A portion of today's event. And, okay, so there was an interesting question that you might have seen on some of the banners. The question is, how is Cisco Adaptive Security Appliance making your new car safer? And three options are there, so you can also respond, and I'll be answering this interesting question after a bit of time. The option is Cisco SA is part of the infrastructure for NCCAR, an organization that assists in the testing of safety of new cars. Option B, Cisco SA is a part of the NASCAR circuit. Option C, Cisco SA came out in 2004 as part of the National Safety Initiative for Few Cars. So let me see if you get this correct. And moving on, like I mentioned, Akhil, Sumanta, and Parminder, they'll be available for next 2 weeks. That is from July 30th to August 9th. We are the Ask the Expert. And please, you can ask any follow-up questions for these 2 weeks. They are available to respond to all your queries. And we'll be posting the video, the recording of this session, in 5 business days, along with the questions that you have submitted today with answers. And earlier, many of you have asked that where I can download the presentation. So the same document link that I mentioned, you can access in the firewalling community. And okay, so interestingly, we have recently launched the rating for documents, blogs. Earlier, it was only for discussions. So now you can rate all the contents, so authors will get the points. So for more information, you can go through this document that will give you more details about how the rating works. So if you are author of any document or blog or video, you will be getting points when people or users rate. And interestingly, we have recently launched the latest mobile app for iPhone, iPad, and Android. And also, this new app will give you access to the localized communities that we have today, Spanish, Portuguese, Japanese, Russian. And you can access these communities from this mobile app. So this is the latest mobile app. So I'd request everyone to try and explore. So on the move, you can access the community. And many of us, many of you already know about the Expert Corner, but this is where all the events that happen, all the expert documents and videos that we promote, you can get them in this Expert Corner. It's very simple. Once you log in or without login to the Cisco Support Community, you can go to the Expert Corner tab, and you can access various events, archives, existing live Ask the Experts also are listed there. And just to give you an overview of some of the upcoming webcasts, the next one is in Portuguese. It's happening on August 7th. The topic is Cisco IOS XR Software Fundamentals Configuration and Troubleshooting. So if you speak Portuguese, I'd like to welcome you to attend that. The registration link is given in the presentation. Also, it will be posted in the chat. It's happening at 11 a.m. Brasilia City Time. And okay, you can learn about some of the basic concepts of IOS XR software. Okay, moving on. Currently, there are 2 English Ask the Experts live. The third one will be for this webcast. But these are the 2 that is running. RF Gateway 1, the topic from expert Ron Hansen, and you can ask questions about all aspects of RF Gateway. And the another Ask the Expert, the second one that is running, is on topic Cisco Cloud Web Security Transparent Solution by Jennifer. And you can ask questions regarding true transparent experience with Cisco Cloud Web Security using your existing Cisco devices. So again, the same location, go to Expert Corner and click on the tab Ask the Expert. You'll see these 2 events running. The third one is also live, which is hosted by Akhil and team. And do check out the CiscoLive365.com for all the live about 600 sessions that we have from Cisco Live recently held. So do visit that. And if you, like you already know, these are some of the links for the localized community. You can access directly and contribute if you speak any of these languages. And these are some of the social media presence that we have today, like Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Google+. So feel free to browse and check out these. And this will also you know, like wherever you are from the social media, you can access the community. And here is the trivia answer. So the option is A, and I see maximum people have responded, 71%. So this is really good. Great. Okay, so I think that concludes our today's session. And I'd like to thank Akhil, Sumanta, and Parminder. I think they had a busy session responding to all the questions. Those pending questions, we'll be responding via the FAQ document, which we'll be posting. At the same time, you can ask all questions that you have related to this topic via the Ask the Expert that will be open shortly. The thread is already active in the firewalling community, but we'll be posting some of the widgets so that you can access from homepage, Expert Corner. So thank you all. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.